So this is Ham Radio Now from the Orlando HamCation. Don't know what number this is going to be, but I know what the name is going to be. How to make a small fortune in amateur radio. I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ. If you enjoy the program, get something out of it, stop by the website, hamradionow.tv. Visit Arvin at the bottom of the homepage. You can make a contribution through PayPal, through a credit card, or a monthly contribution through Patreon. It'll explain it all on the website, hamradionow.tv. You guys know the joke, right? How to make a small fortune in ham radio?
Yeah, you start with a larger one.
Yeah,
of course.
Yeah, I guess that's the true in a lot of industries. You guys are my booth mates here at the HamFest, one on one side and one on the other side. Introduce yourselves. Who are you?
I'm Jim Trapani from JT Communications, Ocala, Florida.
What's your call sign, Jim?
KA2MBE.
And you are?
I'm Dave Bottom. I'm with Arlan Communications. We're located on the central coast of California, San Luis Obispo. And my call sign is Whiskey India 6 Radio.
All right. You guys are both small businesses, and you both generated your own small business, right?
Yes.
That's right, yeah.
And is ham radio your primary market, or is this just a side end of things? I know ham radio is all your stuff is good for.
Yeah, pretty much prime market.
Yeah, well, we've actually built commercial headsets for about 30 years, and it's about 7 years ago that I decided that for my own personal station, I needed to build headsets. And I actually never considered I would be building headsets for other hams, but the result of building a listen-only headset and a boom mic headset, I'm really a CW operator, but I need a mic when I'm chasing DX2 to work them on sideband. And the result was, though, I kept having to build them for all my friends. And I think I built like 16 headsets for hams, and one of my neighbors, John W6SL, suggested that I really should be building these for other people, because where else can you buy something like this? So that was kind of the nudge to, well, maybe we should do this, and that way other people can have a commercial quality headset.
Okay, so we know what you build. Build. It's the headsets. You got a couple of samples here.
Yeah.
You can, I think you're, that camera's pointed at you. You can kind of show it up there.
Sure. So
you can see whether you're.
It's designed after our commercial headsets, obviously, but there's many, many, many differences between what we build for the commercial markets and what's built for amateur radio. And really, the advantages is being able to leverage what we're doing in the commercial space and do it here. And the result's been, such that, we sell thousands of headsets all around the world, have distribution all around the world. And I never anticipated it would be anything like this. I actually probably work harder than even some startup companies in the Bay Area do.
So it's a big deal. It's not a garage business.
No, it certainly isn't. I mean, we do, my wife and I actually do all of the amateur radio headsets outside of our commercial market, where we build only for OEMs. And the amateur radio market really is special. I mean, we have a lot of things that are very different, and we have lots of new products in the amateur market coming out that we have to work with, so that keeps us pretty busy.
And it sounds like you're not struggling.
No, it's a good, healthy business, and I mean, it's amazing. I mean, that we have distributors in the UK and Germany and Russia and Dubai and Australia and most recently China, which is turning out to be a huge market for us. So it's kind of fun to ship things the other way.
So a bigger business than I was thinking it might be. It's hard to tell from a booth here.
Yeah, I mean,
convention.
This is a hobby, amateur radio. So, what we do is really tailored to the other people like us.
Yep. So your business is definitely more just strictly in ham radio.
Pretty much.
And you make a automatic antenna tuner for screwdriver antennas.
Exactly. I actually started out in the broadcast industry doing some manufacturing of broadcast transmitters, designed some equipment mainly for that industry, and I was approached by a manufacturer of antennas to help them sell their product, and that's basically how...
You can say Tar Heel.
Yeah, okay. Basically, Tar Heel approached me and says, we'd like you to develop something through a mutual friend. I met with them and came up with the product, and that's basically how it became known. We've been doing it now for about 2 years, and it's continuing to grow.
And you guys do your own engineering?
Yeah, I'm sure he does, and we do as well. And that's a big advantage of tooling and manufacturing your own product, because you have great control.
So hams come wandering through a ham fest like this, and there's a lot of booths that look like yours, a single booth selling usually a single fairly specialized product. And if they're interested, they look at the product. Maybe they buy one. They never learn what's behind it. So I wanted to look a little bit more in depth about what's behind it. You talked a little bit about how you got started, you mentioned how you got started because you were kind of asked to do it. Well, had you already started to build one?
No.
Why would somebody ask you to build an antenna tuner if you'd been engineering radio stations?
I had a mutual friend between myself and Tar Heel, and we worked at another company together. And after we left that company, he called me and said, they're in the market for looking for a product. Would you be willing to speak to them? I said, sure. And we met with them, and we discussed what they would like. And basically, I came up with a working prototype, and they liked what they saw. I actually showed it to them at this HamFest 3 years ago. And from there, it became a product. They were willing to help a little bit with the financing. And we came up with an agreement. I went further into the production end of it, and that basically is how the product began.
So where do you build yours?
Right in Ocala, right? I actually have an extension to my facility in my house, and I've added on to that.
So you built it in your garage?
Pretty much. That's how it began.
Now, are you struggling, or is this a product that sells itself?
It sells itself. It's got very good reviews. We are very strong in customer support. We feel that it's very important to have that communication between ourselves and the customer. And it shows. It really reflects in the feedback they give us.
So I was kind of expecting this program to go in the direction of, hams are cheap. We can't get them to be interested in anything or buy anything that's high quality product and might cost a little bit more than a Baofeng handy talkie. I'm not getting that story here.
No. Surprisingly, I think everyone has that initial reaction, and even I did. I didn't think people would really pay for the kind of quality we were building in commercial headsets, for example, I was proved to be wrong, because I was nudged into actually building them and offering them, and the result was I was quite shocked, because the first time I showed them, we sold like 13 headsets in 4 hours, and I go, okay, I give up. it's obviously people will pay for quality, and I mean, I know this. I mean, I spent 40 some years in the electronics industry in the Bay Area, and even when I retired, I ran a small software company in the UK, and I started their operations here in the US. And on one of those trips, I spent in Shanghai, and I happened to be one afternoon in a Porsche dealership where I saw $750,000 to $200,000 Porsches get delivered. So it doesn't matter where you are in the world, there is money, and people will buy, and high quality ends up being cheap in the long run. And so people who have money actually probably spend less, because they buy really high quality, and that's...
Like a salesman thing, but I'm sure it's also true.
His comments about feedback, that's critical. I mean, that's really the thing, and it's one of the things that's always been the strongest with companies in the U.S. doing anything, and in amateur radio, especially so, feedback from customers and giving customer support, there's nothing more important than that.
Did you have trepidation going into it that, is this ham radio market, is this something that, the cheap ham thing? I mean, there's even a dealer who calls himself cheap ham, just taking after the concept. But
I was a bit apprehensive at first. I didn't know what was going to happen. It's a chance that you take. But when the dealers basically start picking up interest in it and start placing orders, that's when you start to feel a little bit more positive about the direction of what's going to happen.
Have the businesses grown or pretty much start out where you were initially be able to manufacture a number of units? Is that where it stayed, or is it getting bigger and bigger?
It's gotten a little big. We've got a second product now, and we're working on another supplement to some of the products we have. So it's slowly growing, but it's a you have to be very methodical about what you do, particularly with new products, because you don't know what the people are going to feel about it. Some of the product, one product we're considering, has a limited market, but we're not expecting to see a large sale amount, but we're doing it as an option for certain customers.
I mean, you can say what it is if you want, or you can stand by. Yeah,
it's a supplement to the product that we've got now, but it helps improve the tuning with a loading coil, variable loading coil. Basically, it's a tapped loading coil.
Something attached to the antenna,
right,
to make the tuner work better.
Right.
Yeah. So the two products are a total automatic tuner that will know where it's going to send the antenna and then fine tune it by looking at the SWR, and then just a little box that people have seen in my car, the MFJ version. I think, mine is branded different, but you've seen eight push buttons around the outside and the display in the middle that counts the number of turns on a counter as the motorized antenna is going up and down. And so that takes it to a preset position, and then I can fine-tune it from there. Your box does it all automatically, but you've got a version that kind of replaces that. Old technology box I've got with something that looks more modern but does about the same thing.
Right, and we have a smaller version, which is just a memory unit that for people that don't want to spend the larger amount of dollars for the full-blown version, they can get a smaller, simpler version.
Yeah. So how about your business? Has it grown from where you first started?
Oh, certainly. I mean, I would probably say that we've tried to somewhat cap the growth because it could get out of hand. And, and when you grow, it takes a lot of money to grow. So, obviously, this started out as something for a hobby that we've had for 50-some years. So, you do need to be careful about it because, markets change and things change. But the biggest thing is that you don't want to grow too fast. And our growth has been steady and sometimes remarkable. That's okay. If you want a big business, you can do other things, but if you want a business like what we're doing, and likewise, we do a lot of semi-special things. We've done things for emergency communication centers. We've built things for handicapped hams. We do a lot of with youth groups and, our local university and Cal Poly has a huge club. And we build some for vintage radios as well for people who collect and restore, because I'm one of those with that addiction as well. So I have way too many radios. But that's something we can do in this market, which is a little bit unique, but it's something we have the opportunity to do.
Yeah. So it is it's a very small market. Compared to other stuff you guys done. Now, this is your first retail. Because working in radio stations, that's a different world.
Correct.
So I'm not sure how you would judge whether it's a small market, but compared to your commercial business.
Oh, it's tiny. Yeah. Compared to the commercial business.
Yeah. But you do it because you love it.
Well, yeah. I mean, you can't really do something quite like this unless you're really passionate about it. But that, honestly, that's true of every business. I mean, in industry, it's the same way. And I started out at Hewlett-Packard. Unfortunately, that was in the 60s when, that was a model company. I mean, through my life, I've seen people who've never worked for a well-run company, and that's a tough thing because they've never had an opportunity to learn. So I'm very thankful for my opportunities that I had, and that's really helped me a lot in doing this. And so it's not too scary to do it. You just have to be a little wiser about what you do.
So somebody out there in the audience is thinking, I want to get into a ham radio business. I've got a product I think would sell. And I don't know what to do. What would you recommend? What pitfalls are there to watch out for? What opportunities to grab? assuming that they don't want to build headphones or auto tuners because we don't want competition. You got a little brand name competition, don't you?
Sure, sure. And that's actually good. I mean, you know, it's like a, you know, the
you're talking into one of his mics now. So.
Yeah. I started out at Hewlett Packard, ended up at Intel, which is an odd ending. But you know, I'd been through, you know, test equipment and telecommunications and, you know, microwave radio and all sorts of things. And how do you end up in computers? Well, computers are everywhere now, so it's kind of natural. But the, you know, the interesting thing about amateur radio is it's really just looking for a need to fill. I wasn't looking for it. I just stumbled on it. So it was really quite by accident.
And they asked you to do it. So.
Yeah. So and that's good.
So neither one of these came from that burning ambition in the middle of the night. You said, I just got to do this. I'm going to try these on. I'm not sure I'm going to be able to hear you when I...
Well, there's 24 dB of noise isolation, so it helps for, you know, the situation. You're on the beach in a de-expedition, and it's, you know, the waves are crashing or the wind's banging on the tent or whatever it is, the guys at Heard Island or whatever. But
So they're noise-canceling enough I couldn't hear anything you're saying. But they're lighter than I thought and very comfortable, at least in initial wearing, although any headphones, you wear them for hours and hours, that's when you can tell.
Yeah, exactly.
You know, how they're going to be.
You know, but one of the other things that's really interesting about amateur radio, it's really unique, is we have a marketing opportunity that's unheard of in most industries.
What is that?
Well, it's a government database in every country.
Oh, you know who your customers
could be.
You
know exactly who your customers are, and as a matter of fact, we have wonderful things like QRZ.com, which tells you who's even active, because they have, you know, QRZ pages and they have information on it. And so, you know, you can get great amounts of information to do marketing, which is unheard of in most industries. So it's not really hard, but the tough thing is knowing there's a need and then finding the best possible people you can have to do testing and feedback right at the beginning.
So you're talking about putting a little cap on your potential market, just trying not to grow too fast. And I don't know if you've got that problem, but is there any other warnings to someone? Because if you get a product and people say, oh, I like that, and suddenly you sell a bunch, can you overreact and try to make too many and then, you know, end up, even if it's popular, in a financial bind or just discover that, wait, the market wasn't as big as it seemed like from the initial surge?
Yeah, although amateur radio, I think the biggest problem is the aging population in amateur radio. That's our number one problem. That's why I try to spend a lot of time with youth groups and with the college university station. And, you know, that's something that everybody...
Build a new market.
Everybody in amateur radio that's doing anything needs to be paying attention to how we get younger people involved. And it's probably not how we got involved, you know, 50 years ago or whatever. And it's interesting. And Friedrichshafen this year, it was quite amazing to see the average age there some 15 to 20 years younger than here. And that has a lot to do with
the
exposure.
Big Hamfest in Germany.
Yeah.
I think most people are familiar with, but there might be some that not familiar with. That's what they call the Dayton of Germany, although I think they probably ought to call it the Orlando of Germany at this point.
Yeah, it was about 40% from other countries, which is pretty remarkable. So, and maybe even more than that this year, which they said was probably the most diverse they've seen. But it was quite interesting. They have a really different exposure to young people. It's also in parallel with the Maker Faire there, so that had some, you know, effects on it. But that's a big factor. That's more of a concern I have than, you know, whether single product is the market going to age and go away.
Has that been your worry too, or are you suddenly now worried about it?
What's interesting about the ham radio community is you have a range of people anywhere from doctors to children. In the hobby, and it's such a diverse market that you never know who's out there as far as what their interests are or what they would like specifically about certain products and certain ideas. Everybody has a different idea as to what they like to see in a product. Everybody always tries to give you ideas to, well, it should do this or it should do that. And when you're coming
but you
up,
get a lot of help too, don't you?
Yeah, yeah, yeah. But all in all, the people that you interact with really help you in some of the decisions you make, in marketing-wise and idea-wise.
Yeah.
You mentioned something earlier about, you say, hams are cheap. Well, I wouldn't say the word cheap. I'd say they're very cost-conscious, to be correct, to be politically correct, if you want to be that way. Cost-conscious meaning they want to get as much as they can for what they're spending. They're very particular about, will the product do as advertised? There are some products that are out there that aren't quite meeting what they expect to see.
Yeah.
And that's something you have to overcome as a new prospective dealer or manufacturer and a new with a new product.
I'm thinking the concept of cheap hams is maybe not so much what individuals actually do as what other hams expect them to say. You know, it's ingrained in our culture that hams are supposed to be cheap. So if you're talking to another ham about something, say, oh yeah, that's way too expensive. But if they're looking at your product and the price and what they're going to get for it, and they start looking under the hood and see the quality, suddenly maybe their label of cheap ham falls away some.
Yeah, I think so. I mean, you know, the hobby's changed a lot. I mean, you know, when we were young hams, we built a lot of stuff ourselves because that's the only way we could afford to do it. And so there's a difference between, are you cheaper, what can you afford? And there's certainly, you know, there's a threshold of pain, and you have to be within that. But at the same time, if you buy quality, it ends up being, you know, much less expensive in the long run, and that's, you know, that's kind of a critical thing. So you probably want to get as good as you possibly can for what you can afford, and that's a reasonable thing to do.
Also, what's important is the fact that the hams don't necessarily go through the same technical questioning. For example, when you take an exam, there's not the same technical knowledge needed that you did many years ago. It's narrowed down, so a lot of people don't necessarily have the technical qualifications that some of the older hams had, and you have to pass that on to them, some of that information with Elmers and people like that that help the younger hams understand more of the hobby and the whole industry.
Yeah. I guess it's not surprising, but it's good to see that guys like you are interested in that health of the hobby, the next generation. It's not purely commercial. You know, you got into, you were hams before you started doing the business. And so that when I'm thinking of is that next time you go to a ham fest, you out there go to a ham fest and you walk by these little booths, take a little more time. And maybe say hi to the guy sitting behind the booth trying to catch your gaze. He's not going to strong arm you into buying the product, but he'd love to tell you about it a little bit and get to know these guys.
Sure. It's the comments we've heard here, the testing is a lot different. I mean, you know, we used to actually have to draw schematics and in some cases say what's wrong with the schematic that's in front of you.
You're 120 years old.
Yeah, I know. So it's
I've been a ham for 51 years. I had to identify a Colpitts oscillator,
yeah,
but I
right.
didn't have to draw one.
Yeah, we actually had a couple like test questions, I think, on the advanced or extra class that you had to draw it, and maybe it was even in the general class. I don't recall now. That was too many years ago. But the interesting, you know, thing is involved with youth is, well, first of all, when I started working, if you had a ham license, you could get a job in the Bay Area. It was not that difficult. And what people think is that's the way it used to be. It's still that way. If you go into the Silicon Valley, all the networking companies, they're started by hams. And at Cal Poly State University, every ham that graduates from there as a senior has a job before he leaves, and they're sought after. So this is a really, really important thing to get people hands-on in an industry that they would like to work in. And employers really look for this. It's a big, big deal.
So put it on the resume.
Yes, absolutely.
Wear that ARL pin on your lapel.
Yep.
Or what CQ done, or whatever.
Yeah, what you do that shows you have a passion for the kind of work you want to do is really critical, and it's just as valuable today as it was.
All right. The HamFest is coming down around us. I think we're done. Thank you very much. Tell everyone once again who you are.
I'm Jim Trapani, JT Communications. We manufacture a product called TuneMatic.
Automatic antenna tuner. And I'm not sure you're going to knock a good old Bob out of the business, but apparently there's enough room.
Yeah, there is. I mean, it's fine. I mean, you know, Bob introduced headsets to the amateur radio market. There's certainly nothing wrong with what Bob did. Bob, you know, introduced something that just didn't exist, you know, 20 some years ago. And so, you know, it's fine. You know, I just enjoy doing what we're doing. And as long as we're having fun doing it, that's great.
I should have asked you for a website or some way to find who you are.
You can go to TuneMatic.us.
TuneMatic.us. No dashes or anything.
No.
All right. And you are again?
Arlan, A-R-L-A-N, Communications, and that's our website. And it's, you know, RadioSport Headsets. That's our brand name for the headsets, but it's ArlanCommunications.com.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Thanks
Thank
a lot,
you.
Gary.
That is it for this episode of Ham Radio Now from the Orlando HamCation as the HamFest comes down around us. ARVN. No, Ham Radio. It's my old website. HamRadioNow.tv. Find Arvin. He will guide you to making a contribution if you enjoy the program. I am out of here. Gary Pierce, KN4AQ, 73, over and out.
That's cool, Jim, hearing about what you do. You know, not a lot of people hear about how, you know, how these things get started.